Man, it's pretty awesome to have fans. You know, I love Nashville, but it's so cool to, like, Vegas is great too, but it's like to get out in front of some fans and some, you know, around some good country music. It's you know, it's exciting to get out in front of some people. I know the Apex is great, but it's because you got the PI there, so it's, the weight cuts are always really good. But it's just gonna be exciting to have that energy in the room.
Yeah, it's the first time you've been fighting outside of Vegas in a long time.
It's been a while. You know, I think last, like, for LFA, it was my last fight for the title for LFA. That was the last time I had, you know, a lot of fans there. So I'm definitely excited.
When you walk out there, do you feel like you're going to take that moment in and kind of get that crowd vibe and then, all right, focus on the task at hand? Or do you think you're going to focus on
I get pretty zoned in once, you know, like, I'm riding there on the bus. I'm pretty, like, dead set on the fight. You know, I don't really – get, like, I love the fans' energy, and I can't believe how much I missed it. And just thinking about all the fans would be cool and everything. But you know, I'm here for one reason. You know, I'm focused on that.
Awesome. When you think about this fight with Billy, kind of what do you think of him as a fighter and what he's been able to accomplish so far in his career?
Man, he's a dog. You know, I think a lot of people have asked me that, like, you know, preparation for him and things like that. I think that you know, you have to see the fact that he's willing to go all three rounds, and he's like he's down a lot of times where he's losing and then he comes back. And so I've been in that same position, and I respect him a lot in that way. I think he's just, you know, he's a pretty solid guy. I think that he's a, you know, great fighter, but he's got that dog in him, and that's something you can't teach. You know, I've been working with you know, a lot of these kids over the years where they either have it or they don't. Their parents, you know, spend a lot of money on them, and they'll put them in privates. They'll do all these things with the club team and stuff. And you see these kids, they either have it or they don't. And he's one of those guys that he's got it. So,
yeah, he was in here earlier and he was saying you guys are kind of in a similar spot right now coming off of, you know, a loss against a guy in the top 15.
Yeah.
And you're both going to be really hungry. Kind of when you think about this fight and what's at stake here, kind of where do you kind of see that motivation in the camp for this?
Yeah, definitely. You know, it's been motivational from, you know, the day I took the loss with Dan. You know, I really, like, I'm not that guy that sits back and makes a lot of excuses. I really just wasn't 100% for that fight. But once I committed to it and I said I was going to be there, there was no way I would ever even think about turning it away. And I was on a 4-5 win streak, so I had some confidence that probably shouldn't have been there. But I caught Pat early in the first round, and it saved me from probably a loss that fight, because my wrestling was so off for that whole camp for the Pat fight. And then I caught him in the first round, and so I got out of there, like, you know, no wrestling, no, I didn't have to be tested at all. And with the Dan fight, you know, I just couldn't see the entry. He was staying super low. He was moving a lot different than normal. He wasn't overcommitting, and I had no wrestling the whole camp, so I had zero confidence. So just being healed up from that, from the pec and stuff, and, like, being healed up from that and being back to my normal grind with wrestling and jits and everything else, like, it's got my confidence back up, and it's made my striking so much better. So just going into this, I know what's at stake, because we're both right outside top 15, and, you know, you only got one shot around on this, you know, in this career. It's a rough one, but, you know, whoever moves forward from here, I think, you know, is in the top 15 their next fight, and, you know, I'm not taking that lightly at all.
Yeah, sounds like the loss to Dan was kind of a blessing in disguise, right? You get healthy and kind of recalculate come into this one.
Yeah, I have a hard time, you know, admitting to that. But, you know, in a lot of ways it is. It's kind of eye-opener being like, hey, you know, you got to be on 100%. And it's like you have a lot of people around you that are close to you that tell you that, hey, you're not 100%. You're not 100%. So it's like when you actually, you know, get slapped around like that, it kind of opens your eyes. But, you know, I'm definitely ready to go for this fight and excited for sure.
Hey, Damon, do you think that Billy might be taking this fight a bit too soon after his last fight? Just because of the knockout?
I don't think so. I mean, like, you know, it's one of those things where it was a flash, like, jump knee, real quick, pop, first round. He didn't take a lot of damage, honestly. Like, yeah, he definitely was out of it because he got hit and he fell down. He didn't know who was who for a second. And I think that you can't downplay that, you know. If you get hit and you fall down like that, you can't downplay that. But I think there's a big difference of someone getting hit and not waking up for 30 seconds as opposed to someone, like, just popping right back up and kind of being like, hey, what happened? Because it happens in practice every once in a while where you get hit and you're kind of like, hey, I need to stop. But in a fight situation, I think that was as good of a KO as you could possibly have. You know, like, I think if you're on the ground seizing, or if you're, like, unconscious, like, for, you know, 10 seconds or more, that's when you need to take some time off. And I think that he'll be okay. I think that, you know, I was okay, you know, shortly after that fight, and You know, Dan was, you know, he didn't follow up with any shots. Once I fell and the referee stopped it. And that's the thing about mixed martial arts, why it's so much safer than boxing, is because most of the time I could have got back up after that and, you know, kept fighting. And he probably could have got back up and kept fighting after that Barboza fight. So I think there's different types of knockouts, and I think that he'll be okay.
And what do you think about the division as a whole right now? Because, I mean, there's talks of Volkanovski says he wants to go back up to 155.
Yeah.
You know, the Ilya Topuria is up there as well, yeah, saying, hey, I want the next title shot. So
yeah,
what do you think of this division as a whole right now?
You know, the whole jump in weight class to weight class, it's frustrating and everything. But it's like, I think that once you make that move up, there should definitely be an interim title. And then I think that, you know, that the person should be able to defend the title, but the interim title, they should be able to, you know, step in. So if he's not willing to step in and fight Topuria, then if he beats Topuria, then go back up, that's cool. But he can't just come down for one fight and then go back up and come back down. It just freezes up a lot of people. And he's beat, you know, pretty much everybody in the top five. So I understand him wanting to go up, but he should make it more of a permanent choice instead of, you know, just bouncing back and forth, or he should be fighting every 2 months or something crazy. But either way, it's like, I don't know what the answer is, but he's that guy that has, I think he has a lot of the fighters' respect, and he definitely has the UFC's respect to be able to go back up and challenge. And I think there's a lot of ways you could argue that he won that fight with Islam. You know, I think it was pretty damn close, and he's coming up from 45. So, you know, it was pretty impressive to me.
You've mentioned before that you think that you're a pretty good trash talker. Did the situation ever call for that with Billy this time around?
No. I think me and Billy would probably be pretty tight if we weren't fighting. But I think maybe after the fight, we'll probably end up grabbing a beer or something. But it's like, that's the thing about this, is that you have some fighters that think of it as a sport, and you got some fighters that think of it as personal. And, you know, people like to talk trash, whatever. I think it might be a little bit out of fear they do that. If someone were to talk trash to me, I would probably end up laughing at something they say. And, you know, I would definitely go back and forth with them. But I don't really have any true hatred towards Billy, or, you know, I couldn't really get fired up unless he, you know, wanted to make it personal and say something crazy. But I don't think he's that guy. I think he's a pretty solid dude. And I think that, you know, we're going to go out there and scrap. And, like, you know, he's not there to lose. I'm not there to lose. We're willing to go all three rounds, and we both have the gas tank to do that. So I think it's got fight of the night written all over it.
And is there anyone in the division possibly that you've kind of got your eye on, like, that's the dude I want to talk trash with, or?
I don't know. I mean, there's definitely guys like, I don't know. There's no one in the division that I would, you know, I could make a joke about someone if they were to, you know, get me amped up, but I'm pretty damn busy outside of fighting. Like, I don't really have a whole lot of free time to just come up with things, but it happens at my gym all the time. Like, I roast people the whole time we're sparring, and like, maybe that's the thing, maybe I need to talk shit during the fights and, you know, get people amped up. But I do talk a lot of shit. You can ask all my friends and my wife and, you know, my kids. I roast my kids all the time, and they all have pretty good personality. So yeah, I don't know, we'll see. Maybe if someone talks smack, I'll talk smack back. I don't know.
And my last question is, Billy had mentioned earlier that he kind of sees you as a specialist type of fighter. Do you agree with that, or do you think you're more well-rounded? Or
let him think what he thinks. I don't know. Maybe I'm a black belt in taekwondo. No one really knows that. And, you know, maybe I'm a black belt in jiu-jitsu too. I don't know. I've been a purple belt for like 12 years, and then they ended up like talking me into like coming to a Christmas party, and they magically gave me my brown belt. And I was like I don't really care about any of this stuff, like a specialist or not, like whatever. Like, that spinning elbow, someone could just randomly pull that out. Someone could randomly pull out like a spinning heel kick. So I think in this sport, you got to respect everyone's game and think that, you know, they're going to get you at something.